Good afternoon. We start this afternoon's business with portfolio questions on culture, tourism and external affairs. Question number one, David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met European Commission officials and what was discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Discussions between the European Commission and the Scottish Government take place regularly at both ministerial and official level. Routine discussions have continued since the EU referendum to ensure the effective continuation of EU-related business and to underline the Scottish Government's commitment to working with the European Commission. Only yesterday, the Cabinet Secretary for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform attended the EU Environment Council in Brussels, attended by the EU Commission.
David Stewart.
Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary will be well aware that the EU Emissions Trading Scheme is the world's largest scheme for trading emission allowances and is a key weapon in fighting climate change. At the next meeting with the European Commission and indeed UK officials, will the Minister raise ETS, which raises billions of euros to help industry innovate and invest in clean technologies, and is an essential, remains a key part of the Scottish climate change plan?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, clearly, clean technologies and the opportunities and investments that can be afforded by our partnership with colleagues across the European Union is one of the vital factors as to why we have to make sure that we can have some kind of continuing positive relationship with the EU. And in relation to standards, that's clearly important in terms of climate justice and tackling climate change. In terms of my meetings with the European Commission, I would attend the Education and Culture Council in particular, and also in relation to the EU referendum, it would be my colleagues in other portfolios, whether it's the energy portfolio or indeed the climate change portfolio, that would take forward these matters, but I will relay them to the relevant ministers.
Neil Findlay.
When the minister or whichever minister meets with the European Commission, is there any confusion from the Commission, and do they ask why indeed we have so many Europe ministers in the Scottish Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, every minister in this government is not only has responsibility for our international profile, but also on the economy as well. So every single one of our ministers, when they engage with the European Commission, are advancing the economic cause and interests of Scotland. And in relation to my activities, I particularly focus on the bilateral discussions with EU capitals and with the institutions. But I think it's very, very important that we don't descend into parochial and inward-looking approach, which I think some people in this chamber would like us to see. I hope Neil Findlay isn't one of them.
Question number two, George Adam.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how the historic environment can promote culture in towns and cities.
Cabinet Secretary.
The historic environment promotes culture in our towns and cities in many ways. It's intrinsic to our sense of place and strong cultural identity. It tells the story of our shared past and offers creative inspiration. As the physical embodiment of our cultural traditions, a well-managed historic environment helps present a positive image of Scotland around the globe, attracting UK and international visitors and investors. As the backdrop to our daily lives, it supports all forms of cultural activity, providing venues for a wide range of cultural events and meeting places, which are such a feature of Scotland's community life, from folk music to amateur dramatics, literary societies. In every way, the historic environment is at the heart of our flourishing and dynamic cultural life.
George Adam.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. The Cabinet Secretary will know that Paisley has a very high number of listed buildings. Would she agree that this is an asset which is important to the promotion of culture, and although challenging, is one of the many strengths that Paisley has in being named as UK City of Culture in 2021?
Cabinet Secretary.
George Adam continues in his campaign for the city of Paisley. I recognise that Paisley does have one of the highest number of listed buildings in the country. Certainly Paisley Abbey is one of our finest examples of medieval churches, but also in terms of the rich heritage of Victorian buildings and the very important textile and economic history of our country is well illustrated by the cultural connections and the building heritage and the built environment heritage that has passed on from Coates and Clarks, for example. So I think building that into the bid is a very wise thing for the city of Paisley to do.
John Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And declaring an interest as the convener of the cross-party group on towns and town centres, Given her own roots, the Cabinet Secretary will be well aware of a significant and important cultural history of Ayr going back to the 11th and 12th centuries and before, and she will know the need to promote and raise awareness of the tourism potential that exists in Ayr based on its cultural heritage. What contact has her office had with South Ayrshire Council in recent years on this, and is there help that she might be able to provide in future to support tourism growth and cultural development in Auld Ayr Town Centre?
Cabinet Secretary.
I attended a very important visit to South Ayrshire where they were developing their cultural place partnership with Creative Scotland. A lot of that was about the contemporary culture, but it actually then delved into the wider, deeper history of Ayr. I'm very interested, in particular, in our most recent contact with Ayr is in relation to the archaeology that's currently being undertaken with the demolition of some of the buildings that are around the town centre of Ayr. I think the story it will tell of the medieval past of Ayr will be fascinating and will help to enhance what is already a very strong history story about Ayr that can attract visitors from near and far.
Maurice Golden.
I welcome the preservation and enhancement of our historic urban environment, but the true measure of success for such projects in promoting cultural enrichment must surely take account of both the public's ability to access, share and participate in cultural capital, and also, and critically, for a resulting and sustained long-tail dividend. What steps is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that this is the case?
Well, I'm very proud as part of the budget that was just passed last week, which was opposed by the Conservatives, that we actually managed to maintain free access to our museums and galleries, very important, and in the fantastic results we've seen this week in terms of visitor attendances at our key attractions. Of the top six, I think five of them had free access, which was very important, the other being Edinburgh Castle. That is a very important part of what we do, is making sure that people have access to their story, their buildings and their places.
Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that both Historic Environment Scotland and Aberdeen City Council have recently pledged over £1 million towards the revitalisation of landmark buildings in Union Street. Does she agree that this offers the potential for transformation of Aberdeen City Centre over the next 5 years, and is it a model that other cities could also follow?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm very keen that in some of the agreements that are being made, particularly in relation to city deals, that heritage and tourism and culture are at the heart of that, and the transformation of city centres and indeed town centres is very important. Indeed, the CARS projects and funding from Historic Environment has been very important in that. Dalkeith, Kilmarnock have all benefited from that. But in terms of the investment, I know in the Music Hall, for example, in Aberdeen, that's been something that I've had a keen interest in and has had support from government agencies and indeed from Creative Scotland to Historic Environment Scotland have been very critical in some of that funding. So we work very hard to deliver that, and I think it's really important, and I'm delighted that the support is there from Aberdeen City Council as well.
Question number three, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how successful it considers Celtic Connections 2017 has been for Glasgow and Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Celtic Connections has grown since 1994. It's the largest winter music festival of its kind in the UK. In 2017, it hosted 2,375 artists, 1,800 hours of music on 26 stages throughout Glasgow, 110,000 tickets, 80% of shows were sold out, breaking all previous records. An independent impact study conducted on behalf of Celtic Connections found that it generated over £7 million from visitors in Scotland, providing a benefit of over £4 million across Scotland. Success and cultural highlights for 2017 included La Banda Europa, Inspiring Women, the Canada 150th anniversary, and a very successful Brazilian music showcase.
John Mason.
Yeah, thank you for that answer and very much agree with the points she makes. I mean, some people feel that the definition of Celtic has become wider and wider. Does she think that's a good thing, to be very inclusive, or does the definition of Celtic music need to be narrower?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm the Culture Secretary, and in terms of decisions about what is the curatorial excellence of any cultural activity, I think that is for the festivals and indeed the galleries and museums themselves. What I would say is that internationalist outlook and the fusion, particularly of whether it's Indian traditional musicians and our own, or indeed Brazilian, as I've just mentioned, is very important. But next year, on the 25th anniversary of Celtic Connections, I'm sure John Mason and others will be delighted to know that the partner country for next year will be Ireland, and I think that's about as Celtic as you can get.
Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been well documented in the media that a Tea in the Park sister festival will be taking place in Glasgow this summer. Can I ask what discussions the Scottish Government has had with organisers and Police Scotland about managing the potential impact of antisocial behaviour on local residents?
Cabinet Secretary.
That isn't a matter of the responsibility from myself as Cabinet Secretary, but I think in terms of any major festival, the authority concerned, which will be Glasgow City Council, will be taking forward those discussions with Transport Scotland, but also with Police Scotland. It's very much part and parcel of our event management across Scotland that these agencies work together in order to deliver a great experience for people, and I'm sure the festival will be of great economic benefit to the city.
Question number four, Graeme Dey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress is being made in negotiations with the UK Government regarding the freedom of movement of agricultural and horticultural workers post-Brexit.
Minister Michael Russell.
Presiding Officer, we're aware that the UK's forthcoming exit of the EU has created significant uncertainty within the agricultural sector. We need to ensure the continued protection of the rights of all workers employed in Scotland's rural economy. Limiting free movement of people has the potential to seriously harm Scotland's long-term economic future. There have been discussions and exchanges with the UK government on freedom of movement, including those in the Joint Ministerial Committee on European Negotiations, which I attend alongside representatives of the Welsh Government and the Northern Ireland Executive. Within these discussions, I've consistently raised the importance of freedom of movement to Scotland in terms of contributing to sustainable economic growth, mitigating the effects of demographic change, and enriching our culture and communities. The First Minister has also repeatedly called on the Prime Minister to guarantee EU nationals' right to remain in the UK. Unfortunately, despite our consistent representations to the UK government on this issue, the Prime Minister still refuses to deliver this guarantee despite having the power to do so. The Scottish Government appreciates the importance of obtaining a guaranteed right to remain for EU nationals and will continue to strongly support this.
Graeme Dey.
Thank the Minister for that answer, but can I ask him further? What is it about this Tory government that they seem so incapable of grasping the impact of this uncertainty on the businesses, the economy, just as importantly, the individuals concerned? Or is it that they just don't care?
Minister.
I would hesitate to speculate about the motivations of the present Tory government. They are a mystery to most people. But the Tory obsession with immigration and the Scottish Tories' determination to become born-again Brexiteers are working against the interests of the rural sector, against the interests of our economy, and against the interests of fair treatment of citizens of Europe who are living here. Surely it is time for them to reflect upon it, and having reflected, to act.
Peter Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I refer members to my register of interest. The Minister will be aware that farmers north and south of the Tweed will be looking carefully at the issue of agricultural workers. Does he agree with me that the UK's Brexit approach should be based on economic issues across sectors and not geography?
Minister.
I think that Mr. Chapman is right to say that the economic focus is of great importance. The economic importance of freedom of movement and the economic importance of migration is very great indeed in Scotland. Were he to travel westwards to my constituency, he would see a constituency that is losing population from the rural areas, which there is a shortage of labour, which needs to be replaced by European migration. 90% of the growth in population in Scotland in the next 20 years is anticipated to come from European migration. I would hope Mr. Chapman would stand up for the people who elected him, the people of Scotland, and stand up for Scotland. But I keep hoping that from Scottish Tories, Presiding Officer, and I never hear it.
Question number five, Jackson Carlaw.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to acknowledge and commemorate the role of the founding director of the Edinburgh International Festival, Rudolf Bing, in this its 70th anniversary year.
Cabinet Secretary.
In recognition of the 70th anniversary of the founding of Edinburgh's festivals, the Scottish Government is providing an additional £300,000 of funding through the Edinburgh Festivals Expo Fund. Each festival will develop their own celebrations of the anniversary and their specific Expo-funded projects, with the Edinburgh International Festival announcing their programme on the 15th of March, and they intend to mark Rudolf Bing as the founding director in 1947.
Jackson Carlaw.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Rudolf Bing, of course, was a Jew, and tonight in Edinburgh City Chambers there will be a reception to commemorate and celebrate the 200th anniversary of the Jewish community here in Edinburgh. She'll be aware of the International Shalom Festival, which brings together Israelis of all religions for an evening of culture and performance at the Edinburgh Festival. Now, because of the minority But vocal protests faced last year, many venues are reluctant to host the Shalom Festival this year. In the light of this, what support can the Scottish Government give to ensure that the Shalom Festival is able to continue in this, the 70th anniversary year of the Edinburgh Festival, founded by a Scottish Jew?
Cabinet Secretary.
Every festival are responsible for how they support those that come. Some are curated, some aren't. And in terms of the festival that he's talking about, I'd be interested to see the details of which festival is being celebrated as part of. But it's very important that we send out a message to all communities that we are an inclusive and open society. And in celebrating those that contribute today and in the past, we should also be mindful of how we conduct ourselves will be understood across the world.
Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The director of the Edinburgh International Festival has previously stated that the poisonous rhetoric of Brexit talks could seriously damage the festival. Unfortunately, something that Jackson Carlaw's UK government colleagues bear responsibility for. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the interests of our culture and creative industries are best served by protecting Scotland's strong relationship with the EU?
Cabinet Secretary.
Our festivals are testament to the importance of that international reach, and in terms of our cultural and creative industries that are in Scotland, freedom of movement is absolutely vital. Yeah. It's an economic interest of this country, but also in terms of the culture and creativity of those connections, that's irreplaceable. And if the disruption to that, or even the threat of disruption to that, causes harm to our culture and creative life, the manifest of that will not be just experienced by those in the current day, it will be experience for generations to come. That's how serious freedom of movement is to this country.
Question number six, Angus MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it's making in securing additional funding for BBC Alba.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has made strong, clear and consistent representations to the BBC in order to secure additional funding for BBC Alba. The BBC announced on 22nd of February they would cover the £1.2 million cost of Gaelic programmes BBC Alba to date has funded, releasing welcome funds for BBC Alba. Separately, they will support weekend news coverage. We look forward to receiving further details from the BBC in order to understand more fully what the implications and benefits of the recent announcement will be. We will continue to press the BBC to deliver more for Gaelic broadcasting so that we can move towards parity with the resources afforded to S4C.
Angus MacDonald.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her reply, and I certainly join her in welcoming the extra £1.2 million for BBC Alba. That said, the Cabinet Secretary may be aware of concerns in the Gaelic community following last week's new channel announcement that the creation of the channel could result in a detrimental impact on funding for BBC Alba. With the commitment given last week of up to 7.2 hours fresh in-house programming for BBC Alba per week, the BBC investment announced last week falls well short of what BBC Alba needs to ensure it can sustain its historic success and continue to be an effective contributor to the revitalisation of Gaelic. The Cabinet Secretary has given a commitment to impress upon the BBC the need for a 10 hours per week in-house contribution, and I would urge her to continue to do that. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the case for BBC Alba is well made. Indeed, I think has been fairly instructional in how BBC programme making can actually help develop and support the creative industries. We have a debate later on this very matter, but it is essential that 10 hours per week of in-house contribution to BBC Alba is secured. That is not what's been secured to date, and it's something that we'll continue to support and we will continue to make the case for.
Question number seven, Neil Findlay.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made in developing links with Qatar.
Minister Alistair Allen.
The Scottish Government remains open to opportunities to engage with Qatar through diplomatic, economic, educational and cultural ties. In addition, Scottish Development International's Middle East office, based at the British Embassy in Dubai, works closely with companies from countries in the Gulf region, including Qatar, who are looking to invest, relocate, partner or expand in Scotland. Scotland has a strong and enduring commitment to securing democracy, the rule of law and human rights across the world, and as a good global citizen, the Scottish Government takes this seriously when exploring links with any country. We expect all states to comply with international human rights law, and we use our international engagement as an opportunity to promote respect for and understanding of human rights.
Neil Findlay.
The Scottish Government previously dispatched the former First Minister and the current Transport Secretary to Qatar to build cultural links and to flog public service infrastructure to the Qatari Sovereign Wealth Fund. Can the Minister now tell me what investments have been made in our public infrastructure and in our cultural sector by the Qataris at the same time as building workers lose their lives on World Cup projects in Qatar?
Minister.
Well, let me address directly the points made about human rights, since that is legitimately what the question being asked is about. I think it is important to say, and he mentions him, that my distinguished predecessor, Humza Yousaf, has raised specifically the issue of migrant worker rights with the ambassador of Qatar. He did so on the 10th of March 2015. Humza Yousaf also met with Amnesty International regarding Qatari human rights and was briefed by them. And he has raised similar issues at the Festival of Literature that took place in the Emirates in 2015, specifically on the issue of construction. I know that Humza Yousaf also spoke with the Qatari authorities regarding specifically human rights and the World Cup. And indeed, that is something which the Scottish Government has continued to keep an eye on.
That concludes our questions on culture. We move on to justice and the law officers. I start with question number one from Lewis MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recent update report by Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland on call handling in Police Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
The Scottish Government welcomes the publication of the HMICS update report on call handling and notes the considerable progress made by Police Scotland since November 2015's HMICS independent assurance review on the same subject. We expect the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland to give careful consideration to the findings of the update report and to continue working closely with HMICS as they seek to further strengthen their approach to police call handling.
Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much. Given that the report says that limited progress has been made in improving the functionality and accuracy of the gazetteer used by control room staff, and that nearly a quarter of all notable incidents were because the wrong location was chosen by the service advisor, what further action will the Cabinet Secretary now take to address these issues? Will he, for example, reconsider at this stage his plans to close the control rooms in Aberdeen and Inverness, which can only lead to an increase in such incidents?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, as the member will recognise, the report overall does show very good progress that's been made by Police Scotland in the way in which they are taking forward reforms around call handling. And only last week, the Chief Inspector of HMICS gave evidence to the subcommittee of the Justice Committee on Policing, where he praised the work that had been taken forward by police call handling staff and the service in taking forward this area of reform work. He has identified an area where there's an issue around stability of the gazetteer system. There is a practical issue here. And a practical issue is that we have three emergency services that have historically all used separate gazetteer systems for the very same purpose. Our ambulance service has one, our fire services had one, and our police services had one. And one of the areas of work which is being considered is the use of a single gazetteer system which would be used for all of our emergency services, which would ensure that it was most up-to-date as possible. And that's an area of work which we would expect to continue to see progress be made on. But overall, from the assurance review, we're now in a situation where of the 30 recommendations, 16 have been discharged, 12 have been partially discharged, and only two remain open. And the issue around the intended changes in Aberdeen and Inverness are areas of work where there is still progress being made. The assurance review group met only yesterday to consider the ongoing changes at Aberdeen. And that there will be further work taken forward over the coming weeks, but it demonstrated that very good progress is being made in the change and transfer in Aberdeen, and that the SPA will consider that further at their next board meeting on the 22nd of March. So I don't have good news for the member in this call for the call centre changes in Aberdeen and Inverness to remain open. Obviously, Inverness is changing for another purpose under Police Scotland in the way in which it's going to be operating. But what I can give him an assurance is that good progress has been made, and the assurance review, what that I directed and expect HMICS to continue to make progress on, will continue to be reviewed and monitored as we move forward with this.
Question number two, Peter Chapman.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to improve the completion rate of community payback orders.
Cabinet Secretary.
Delivering community payback orders and ensuring completion of these orders is the responsibility of the relevant local authority. The National Outcomes and Standards for Social Work Services in the Criminal Justice System contains guidance on the procedures involved and the actions that social work case managers can take in cases where the individual is failing to complete their order. This can include returning the case to court. This government is committed to supporting local authorities in delivering robust community sentences, and funding for criminal justice social work remains at record levels. We also invested an additional £4 million in community services in 2016-17, and this additional funding continues in the Scottish Budget for this coming year. And from the 1st of April, our new model for community justice will come into effect. Statutory community justice partners will jointly plan and deliver services to prevent further offending and support those who have offended to reintegrate into communities. A new public body, Community Justice Scotland, will provide national leadership in this area and report to ministers on performance across Scotland. It will promote improvement in the delivery and impact of community justice services, including prevention, early intervention and community sentences.
Peter Chapman.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. But the fact is that nearly a third of orders were not completed in 2015-16, and completion rates have fallen for 2 years in a row. More needs to be done to reverse this worrying trend, especially as it has emerged that CPOs are being handed out for serious sex offences. Will the government commit to an urgent review of the system of community payback orders to ensure criminals don't start treating them with contempt?
Well done. Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member clearly isn't aware that there was actually a full review of community payback orders back in 2015. Which was published in looking at the way in which CPOs were operating. In the view of that review, identified that there was a broad degree of confidence about how community payback orders were being taken forward. In fact, I'll quote from the review where it states that sheriffs appear to have broad confidence in CPOs in terms of monitoring of progress and appropriate use of breaches. So there already has been a review of community payback orders. In relation to matters regarding completion rates, the member is obviously not aware that completion rates for community sentencing has increased over recent years from around 62% back in 2006-07 up to just over 68% in the last year or so. We are continuing to look at what further measures can be done in order to make sure that the benefits of CPOs are taken forward, and we'll always look at other measures which can add value to them, including ensuring greater levels of completion rates.
Liam MacArthur.
Thanks very much, President Officer. And I welcome much of what the Cabinet Secretary said, as you'll be aware the latest statistics show that in terms of reoffending, those in community payback orders have the lowest levels of reoffending. By contrast, those serving sentences below 3 months have the highest rates of reoffending. On that basis, will the Cabinet Secretary update Parliament on when we will be moving to raise the minimum sentence to 12 months to reduce the levels of reoffending?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member makes a very important point, and the evidence base does demonstrate that community payback orders and community sentencing is much more effective than short-term prison sentences. The evidence does show that someone who receives a community disposal is much less likely to go on to reoffending compared to someone who receives a short-term sentence of 6 months or less. Actually, someone who receives a sentence of 6 months or less is almost twice as likely to go on and reoffend than someone who completed a CPO. So looking at these matters, as the member will be aware, I'm very clear that we need to make sure we use the evidence that demonstrates the benefits of CPOs, not just in the issue of reducing reoffending, but also the benefits that are then provided to local communities through CPOs. And we know that in the last report, annual report of CPO provision, there were some 1.8 million hours of unpaid work provided in local communities right across Scotland through this scheme. And on his point regarding the presumption against short sentences, I know this is a matter which the member has considerable interest in, as I have, but I will intend to update Parliament in due course on this particular matter following some further work which is presently being carried out.
Question number three, Adam Tompkins.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that 30% of sheriff courts are failing to reach the 26-week target from caution or charge to verdict.
Minister Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would just remind members of my entry in the Register of Interest, wherein they will note that I'm a member of the Law Society of Scotland, hold a current practising certificate, but I'm not currently practising. In response to Mr Tompkins' question, the 26-week indicator from caution to charge to verdict covers activity not just on the part of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, but obviously also of Police Scotland and the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service. When, in fact, we compare the period December 2014 to November 2015 with December 2015 to November 2016, national performance has increased from 64.2% to 66.1%. I would also say that in recent years, the reporting and detection of crimes, particularly domestic abuse and sexual offences, has increased, reflecting proactive policing and prosecution and greater victim confidence to report crimes. These cases have not only increased in volume, but are more complex cases, often requiring more court time. This has placed additional pressure on the Crown, the courts and the wider justice system, and we have and continue to respond to these pressures, and additional resources have been made available.
Adam Tompkins.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but, Presiding Officer, almost half of Scotland's 40 sheriff courts are performing worse now than they were a year ago, including Glasgow and Strathkelvin, with only 53.3% of cases concluded within the target 26-week period. Solicitors working at the sharp end of our criminal justice system cite court closures for a backlog of cases and an increase in the number of adjournments. Could the Minister tell my constituents seeking access to justice what action the Scottish Government is taking to remedy this situation?
Minister.
Well, what I would say to the member is that the methodology that he has applied, or his press office has applied, in interpreting and analysing the actual stats collected by the Independent Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service seems a wee bit less than robust, if I may say so. What we need to do is compare not just a one-month static figure with another month in a different year, but look at the figures on a year-by-year basis. And if we do that, we do indeed see that there has been an overall improvement of 1.9% as between 14-15 and 15-16. On the issue of adjournments and the possible effect of court closures, I would say that I don't agree with the member, and he should also bear in mind the independent data collected by the SCTS, which in fact shows that there has been an increase in the overall number of cases, but at the same time, the number of cases that have been reduced as a result of, have been adjourned, in the year 15-16 was 5.6%, and in the previous year it was 6.3%. So that, in fact, represents a reduction.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister touched on the increased reporting and detection of crimes, particularly domestic abuse and sexual offences, and I recall and welcome the funding announcement by the First Minister through the Violence Against Women funding stream that assists in the development of measures to tackle all forms of violence against women. Is this funding helping to improve domestic abuse court performance?
Yes.
The member is right to highlight the additional funding that the Scottish Government has made available to deal specifically with the increased caseload that we have seen in terms of domestic abuse, and we have made available the sum of £2.4 million in each year of 15-16, 16-17, and this will be the case also for 17-18, and indeed we can see that this is having a very significant impact on the time within which trials have been proceeding. There's a current agreed 10 to 12 week period, and from April 2017, the aim is to offer domestic abuse trials within 8 to 10 weeks. And we are very optimistic that that will be achieved on the basis that already 95% of courts are meeting this accelerated timescale.
Mary Fee.
In light of the inquiry carried out by the Justice Committee into the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and the many issues we have heard regarding performance and the serious concerns that have been raised, does the Minister believe that a £4 million cut to the COPFS budget this year will improve and quicken access to justice?
Minister.
I know that the Justice Committee has been looking into the operation of the Crown Procurator Fiscal Service in some great depth, and we await in due course the report of the Justice Committee. A number of figures have been bandied about at the committee, but what I would say to the member, as the member well knows, is that the operation of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service is a matter for ultimately the Lord President, and they do monitor very carefully the performance of the courts. I believe, in fact, on a monthly basis by the Justice System Planning Group, a subgroup of the National Justice Board. And what we are seeing, in fact, is an improvement, as I've already indicated, in terms of domestic abuse, in terms of the general position of the performance of summary criminal trials. So we are seeing an improvement. I think that's down to the great work being conducted by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service.
Question number four, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the time taken to conclude cases in the courts.
Minister.
As I stated in my earlier response to his colleague, the Scottish Government recognises that the reporting and prosecution of certain categories of crime have increased. Criminal investigations have also become more complex, and this is reflected in the number of court cases proceeding to evidence-led trials. Over the last 5 years, there has been a 38% increase in evidence-led trials. However, even allowing for this, the evidence shows an improving picture. As at January 2017, 95% of sheriff courts are offering trials within the optimum of 16 weeks compared to only 50% in April 2014. With the help of additional funding from the Scottish Government, the percentage of cases fully disposed within 20 weeks has increased from 58% in 2014-15 to 67% in 2016-17. So I think it's quite clear that improvement has been made, but obviously there's always more that can be done.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Pressure on Scotland's courts is not a new issue. In 2015, Audit Scotland published a report highlighting the difficulties they face, and the situation only seems to be getting worse. This is after the Scottish Government ignored warnings from opposition parties and slashed the number of courts across the country, including Kirkcudbright Sheriff Court in my constituency. Can the Cabinet Secretary indicate whether the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service has successfully implemented Audit Scotland's recommendations to improve Scotland's court system?
Minister.
Well, I would say to the member that if he looks back at the record of these proceedings at question time today, he will see the various statistics that I have referred to that come from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service themselves in terms of data they have collected and review on a monthly basis, and he will see that the improvements that have been made. The member mentioned Kirkcudbright Sheriff Court. This was closed, I think, some 3 years ago, and it's important to remember that at that time it was dealing with, on average, two summary criminal trials per month. Obviously, Dumfries is now the receiving court, and there has been no impact on Dumfries Sheriff Court following the transfer of this business.
Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to refer members to my register of interest. I'm a registered mental health nurse. While I'm, of course, very interested in the time taken to conclude cases in court, I have a particular interest in drug courts. Could the Minister please advise what the position is here?
Minister.
What I would say to the member is that what we have seen in Glasgow is a very successful dedicated drugs court, and what we are doing across Scotland is setting up problem-solving courts in Aberdeen, Edinburgh, and recently in Forfar to look at the bigger picture. And therefore, I would say that what we are looking at is looking at the particular position of that individual, and the individual vary obviously from case to case, and therefore in those circumstances it is the outcome for the individual that is the key important determinant, and perhaps not the actual time of the proceedings at court themselves.
Question number five, Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it is making with the implementation of Section 179 of the Criminal Justice and Licensing Scotland Act 2010 regarding disabled access.
Cabinet Secretary.
Section 179 of the Criminal Justice and Licensing Scotland Act 2010 requires individuals applying for a liquor premises licence to provide a disability access and facilities statement along with their application. The statement is to contain information about disabled access to the premises and the facilities and any other provisions available to aid the use of the premises by disabled people. Failure to provide a statement is not a ground for refusing an application, but means that the premises application would be incomplete and could not be considered by the licensing board. The provision does not interfere with the existing duty under equality law to make reasonable adjustment to make sure that a disabled person can use a service as close as it is reasonably possible to get the standard usually offered to non-disabled people. Section 179 cannot be commenced in isolation. It is also necessary to update secondary legislation to provide the necessary statutory forms alongside providing guidance on applicants, to applicants. We intend to complete this work within the remainder of this year.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. In 2010, an amendment was passed with cross-party support following BARD, a campaign run by Mark Cooper in association with Capability Scotland, provided that licensed premises must provide the information he outlined. Unfortunately, the government has yet to enact the law. The government stated that it would do so by the end of this parliament, but that would obviously be a delay of over the decade, so I welcome the commitment that he makes today. Will he, the Minister, could therefore act without delay, ensure that it is enacted within this year, and would he agree with me that for many disabled people, a beer delayed is a beer denied?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, on that point, Presiding Officer, I think it's important to recognise, although there was cross-party support for this particular amendment, it doesn't actually require a licence holder to actually commit to any amendments or alterations to their premises. It's about a factual base of information that has to be provided at the time when an application for a liquor licence is being made. As the member will recognise, there has been a significant amount of new regulations being taken forward around licensed premises in Scotland, including also the introduction of licensing for scrap metal companies and also air weapons as well. And we try to take these forward on a phased basis in order to make sure that we manage that process for those who require to have a licence or to apply for a licence. What I can say to the member is that there are some secondary legislation issues which have to accompany this particular provision, and we will seek to try and make progress on that in over the course of this year. And I will try to make sure that that work is taken forward as early as possible, but at this stage, I can't give them a final date as to when that process will be completed.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. We'll now move on to the next item of business. I'll just give members a few seconds to change seats.